Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the Lake Highlands Presbyterian Church, our 10 o'clock worshiping experience where we're doing our best to make disciples by reaching out, loving, caring, sharing, and inspiring spiritual and personal growth. It's so good to see you all on this morning. And those of you joining us online, God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us as well. My friends, I do have some announcements to make, but before I get started, remember the communication cards in the chair backs in front of you. Fill those out, place it in the collection plate as it comes by during this worshiping experience. And for those of you who are with us online, especially on Facebook, please put something in the comment section to let us know that you're with us on today. We love to hear from you. Always check your e-blast, read the newsletter, check our calendars, follow us on social media so that you can see all the things that the Lake Highlands Presbyterian Church is involved in. Now, I do have these announcements. Today is the last day that we'll be taking names for the session class, nominating persons for the session class of 2026. Today's the last day. So if you've not turned in names, make that happen today. You can get them to me. You can get them to Kelly Tolman, our chairperson of our nominating committee, or other persons on our nominating committee, Ginger Williams, Carol Greenman. You can get those names to us, but today is the last day to get them in. However, it's not the last day to talk about nominating, because as you know, during a congregational meeting, we will open the floor for nominations at that point. But if you want a person nominated through the session, this is the route to take. Make sure you get those names to us on today. As always, do these things. Make sure that the person that you want to, whose name you want to turn in, is a member of the church. Make sure that Also, make sure that they want to do it. Please, make sure you talk to them. Ask them if it's okay to place their name in nomination, because we don't want to be surprised, and they definitely don't want to be surprised to hear that happen, okay? So please make sure you have those things covered before you turn names in to us. On this coming Saturday, our green team is hosting another church-wide lake cleanup at White Rock Lake. We're going to be there from 9:30 to 11:30, or however long you're able to stay with us there as we're cleaning up the lake. Now, Cindy's going to tell us where we will be meeting, so make sure you check your emails this week to hear from her. There is a sign-up sheet in the narthex, however, for you to use so that you can get information to her. Now, if you've not done one of these, it's amazing. It's amazing. We ought to be good stewards of the world that the Lord has created. Amen? Yeah, that was kind of weak, but I'm going to let it slide because it's early. I get it. But we ought to be good stewards of this world. And we do this in many ways, but one is by keeping it clean, keeping it clean. So please join us on Saturday from 9:30 to 11:30. Sage will be gathering on this coming Tuesday, October 10th at 10 a.m. Our guest is author Betty Gerson, and she's going to talk about her book, From Montgomery to Matterhorn, A Personal, Political, and Historical Account of Lives in My Two Homelands. So if you're able to be here, we hope that you'll be able to be here on this coming Tuesday to hear Ms. Gerson. We are asking just simply for a $5 donation for lunch if you're going to stay for lunch. And you don't have to pay that in advance. You can give that when you come on Tuesday. Also on this coming Saturday, after the lake cleanup at 1 p.m., there will be an elder summit here at the church. So if you are an ordained elder, ruling or teaching elder, you are invited to come to the summit on Saturday at 1 p.m. Caregivers Connect and Grief Ministry will be next Sunday at 3 p.m., and today is the second Sunday, so committees are meeting on today. I've not heard of any committees that are not meeting on today, so hopefully your space is where you need it and is set up for you and ready for you to go after this worshiping experience. On next Sunday, we will have a reception after worship to say thank you to Dorado Rubel Asbell. As we may mention already, he has received and accepted a position at the Spring Valley United Methodist Church, and we wish him well. But we're going to have a good time celebrating him on next Sunday. Amen? Amen. Elders or session members, please make sure you check your emails today and tomorrow, because we have a meeting on tomorrow night. So please make sure that you do that. And then before I bring up Leanne, on the 22nd of this month, I will not be here, and I'm excited to tell you why. That is the homecoming for Bethel University in McKenzie, Tennessee. And my father, the late Reverend Dr. Joel P. Rice, is going to be honored by receiving the Lifetime Achievement Award posthumously at Bethel during homecoming. He will be the second person in the history of this institution to receive that award. So we are going to celebrate with our alma mater on that particular weekend. And there's something else that is happening with Pop on that weekend that I can't talk to you about right now. But I'll tell you about it when I get back. But you'll be in good hands on that Sunday, on October 22nd. Of course, I will not be here. And Ron is excited because he's going to get a good sermon on that Sunday. And you will get a good sermon on that Sunday because our own, the Reverend Leanne Kerner, is going to be preaching on that Sunday morning. So we're looking forward. Yes. And speaking of Leanne, I'm going to ask that she will come now with any announcements that she has for our youth, children, and families.
Good morning. This feels taller than normal. Just some reminders, there is no youth group tonight. School did not happen on Friday or tomorrow, so we're going to take a break as well. If you want to sign up for meals, there's still a sheet on the table in the narthex. But really the big thing we need you to sign up for is to bring your car for Trunk or Treat on October 28th from 10 until 1. So bring your vehicle, decorate it. There's going to be a contest. I have an excellent decoration, and I can't wait for you to see it. I can't wait to see yours. So please sign up on the Narthex table, or a sign-up sheet went out in the e-blast. So make sure you do those and come pass out candy. Candy will be provided for you unless you just have a treat you really want to bring. Then you're welcome to do that.
Thank you, Leanne. And please, yes, what we do around Halloween here, Trunk or Treat, or it's been called Bootacular in the past, is an amazing opportunity and a gift to the community. So we hope that you'll be able to support our school in this regard. We do have some birthdays this week. Happy birthday to David Faust. Happy birthday to Dolores Alia. Happy birthday to David Godfrey. You have a birthday this week, David? Yes, happy birthday to David. And happy birthday to Tristan Dimmler. Tristan has a birthday, I believe, this week as well. So happy birthday to all of you. And one last thing. I'm happy to announce the birth of a brand new baby to Josue and Vanessa Felix. Yes. Baby is here. Was born Friday evening around 8:30 p.m. Don't have a name yet, but we'll have all of that for you very soon. So we are thankful to the Lord for a brand new child into this world, a blessing to the Felix family. Now, let's worship God.
And at this time, I invite us all to stand and worship in the way that you feel best.
Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of eternal gladness, fill us with the light of day.
You are the one who saves, lift us from the grave.
from the grave. You are the light of life, the everlasting day. You are the one who takes all our sins away. Jesus, you are my rescue. Jesus, you are my rescue. I give you everything I am. Jesus, you are my rescue. Jesus, you are my rescue. I give you everything I am. Jesus, you are my rescue. Jesus, you are my rescue. I give you everything I am. Jesus, you are my rescue. Jesus, you are my rescue. I give you everything I am. You are giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Fountain of the joy of living, ocean depths of happy rest. You are the one who saves. You are the one who saves. You are the one whose hand lifts us from the grave. You are the light of life, the everlasting day. You are the one who takes all our sins away. The one who takes all our sins away. You are the one who takes all our sins
all the time.
Let us pray. Lord, you are good. Yes, you are. And again, yes, you are. We come to you on this day, in this place, in this space, to be able to honor, worship, glorify, and adore you for everything that you do for us in our daily living. We come to this place, dear Lord, this morning, to be able to receive the word through scripture, sermon, and song, so that way we may be able to connect to you in a more way that we feel best for ourselves. As always, dear Lord, for this morning, let us be able to be moved. Let us be able to be restored. Let us also be able to touch those outside the walls of this place. As always, dear Lord, let us be a reminder that us as a folk, are the church. We are the church, not this place, but we are the church. And let us be able to minister to those that would love to be, as I would like to say, churched. It's these things that we pray forever and evermore, dear Lord. Amen.
My friends, may you have hope in Jesus Christ. Now, please share the hope of Christ with those close to you.
Yeah, this morning, the liturgy, the first liturgy, is Joshua 1, chapter verses 1 through 7. And this is from the New International Version of the Bible. And this is where Joshua is installed as leader. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, and from the great river, the Euphrates, and all the Hittite country, to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn away from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go."
Thank you, Todd. My friends, today, beginning today, we're going to start a sermon series on leadership. But we're not going to do it in the conventional manner. You'll get a sermon on leadership today. There will be another one next Sunday. And then the next sermon on leadership will take place in November and then one in December. And that's how we'll work these sermons in, almost like an installment manner. So that's how that's going to happen. And it may carry us on into next year, but we'll see what the Lord has to say in that regard. So our second text for today comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and really just one verse is all that we need. 1 Corinthians 11 and 1. But before we read that one verse, that is correct. Bible check. Yes, we encourage you to bring your Bibles for one verse or for a bunch of verses. We encourage you to bring your Bibles when you come to the house of the Lord. 1 Corinthians 11 and 1. It says this, meaning the words of Paul. "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. Amen. Let us pray. For all that you do, Lord, we say thank you. We are blessed to be in your presence, honored to be able to serve you. And we thank you for all that we've witnessed, for we know that you're using these things to prepare us to hear a word from you. So right now, make me less. Allow me to decrease so that you can increase and become more. And fix us by clearing our minds, opening our hearts, and unstopping our ears so we can hear from you. And upon hearing from you, we want to leave this place better than the way we arrived. Yes, Lord, we just want to be better than the way we were before. In your name we ask it all, amen and amen. If you would please, turn to a neighbor, look at them good, and if you're by yourself, just look at me and repeat after me. Friend, today's sermon is called Leaders Practice Fellowship. Amen. Leaders Practice Fellowship. You will struggle as a leader if you believe you know it all. You will struggle as a leader when you reach a point where you won't listen to anyone or no one can share anything with you. You're going to struggle as a leader. And when you get that way, it's close to having what is clinically called a God complex. A God complex. A psychological illusion where a person believes that they have great power, ability, privilege, and infallibility and are superior to others. Those who have a God complex refuse to admit the possibility of their error or failure, even in the face of irrefutable evidence. It's quite narcissistic in many ways. I'm not speaking of people who have confidence or people who may even be overconfident, but this type of individual does not believe that a group can do anything without them being involved in everything. And if the group does succeed in doing anything, they will quickly point out the things that the group did that were wrong, which would have been better had this person been involved in everything. You see, my friends, as a leader, you really should try to hear everyone. But the reality of the matter is you can't listen to everyone. You see, hearing simply means that your ears work. Hello, somebody. I don't know what they do in schools now, but when I was growing up and going to school, they had hearing tests that we would go through every year. You put headphones on and you would listen for bells and whistles and you would count up all the ones that to prove that your ears worked. Hello, somebody, because if they did not work, it was going to be hard for some people who were given instruction to get it to you. But listening is the ability to take what you hear and process it, to use it for your own betterment or for the betterment of society. And we must use the Lord to help us to know who to listen to. Who to listen to. I'll come back to that here in a little bit. Thank you, Todd, again, for that scripture reading, because I really do want to spend some time with Joshua on today. You see, Joshua was a good follower who supported his leader. He supported Moses. He understood how to support Moses. He understood why he was to support Moses, especially when the multitudes wouldn't. Hello, somebody. You all know the story of this people. We'd rather go back to Egypt, that group. We'd rather go back to bondage than hang out here in the desert with you, Moses, that group. Joshua knew how to support Moses even when the multitudes would not. And while he was a follower of Moses, Joshua himself became a leader under Moses, and he watched, he observed, he learned. So when it was time for him to lead, he was ready. He was ready. Even if he may not have felt like he was ready, the Lord knew that Joshua was ready. Major lesson that Joshua learned from Moses was that leaders, good leaders, still follow. They still follow. I want to share with you one of my favorite movies. I've got about 1.5 million favorite movies. But I want to share with you a clip from one of my favorite movies. It's called Remember the Titans. And in this movie, you have a coach, Coach Boone, and you have another coach, Yost. And Boone comes to this town to be the assistant coach under Yost. Yost being a white man, Boone being a black man. But because of integration, the school district decides to flip their positions without either one of them being told. And Boone becomes the head coach, and Yost becomes the assistant coach. And there's a lot of tension throughout the entire movie. A lot of tension. Coach Boone decides that he will take the offense of the football team and give Coach Yost the defense. And they struggle throughout this season. The city, the town that they're in struggles throughout the entire season due to integration. But they do come to a point of reconciliation and things do work out. But what I want to show you in this clip is the turning point to some degree when the leader becomes the follower. Please.
Coach, get a timeout. Timeout.
Coach, just slant to a strong side every time. You got to catch him in that slant and let him over pursue. He's onto your game. You got to throw something at him he's not ready for.
Rev! Ms. Rev.
Yes, sir.
All right, listen, you ready to run?
Yes, sir.
Fake 23 blast with a backside George reverse. You got that? Fake 23 blast with a backside George reverse like your life depended upon it. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
The Titans take the field with time to run one final play for the state championship.
I thought he was injured. I guess not. Why are they bringing in a QB?
The Titans have 75 yards to get to the end zone.
I can't watch this. Cheryl, what's wrong?
No, I can't.
Cheryl.
Watch
it. No, it's too bad. Not now. Cheryl.
Not now.
Throw it deep. Cover deep. Watch the deep pass. Cover deep. And
now, without trying to get into the specifics of football, which I really want to do, but nevertheless, without trying to get into that, let me just try to unpack what you actually saw. Coach Boone, played by Denzel Washington, Coach Boone is new to the area, does not know the opposing head coach, a guy by the name of Ed Henry. But Yost does. And this is the state championship. And what Coach Yost does, he comes to Boone and he basically says, he knows what you're doing. So you're going to have to give him something that he's not seen before. Now, there's some options here. The worst option would have been for Boone to say, stay on your side. I know what I'm doing. Move away. That would have been the worst option. A bad option would have been for Yost to not say anything at all. But instead, Yost tells Boone what he needs to hear, and Boone listens. Boone, Coach Boone, listens. Joshua learned a lot from watching Moses, but on one occasion, he learned that good leaders delegate. And he learned this because Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, comes to visit, brings his wife, Zipporah, their sons. And Jethro watched Moses overwork. He's up early in the morning handling disputes. All day long, he's handling disputes. On into the evening, he's handling disputes. He gets up the next day and does the same thing. And Jethro finally comes to Moses and says, what you're doing is not good. You're going to wear yourself out. Moses, what you need to learn how to do is delegate. Find some good leaders who can handle some of these minor disputes and set them up, teams of hundreds and tens or what have you, and let them handle the minor disputes and let the major disputes come to you. And Moses listens, and he does. He does what his father-in-law suggests. And Joshua sees this happen. You see, a good leader knows what she doesn't know and will quickly identify areas of personal uncertainty in relation to its importance to the group. And when this happens, then the good leader becomes a follower. The leader follows. You see, my friends, leaders don't have all the answers. Some leaders don't have most of the answers. But a wise leader knows how to find someone who does. A wise leader knows how to find someone who does have the answer, who does know the answer, and will use it to lead the group into a greater place. So a good leader needs to know how to follow. How do leaders know to do this? Who to listen to and when to practice fellowship, when they need to lead and when they need to follow? How do good leaders know this? Here's the truth. Good leaders don't. They don't know when to do these things. So they rely on the one who does. Paul begins this chapter in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 by vouching for his own leadership skills. He says, "Follow my example as I follow the example of Christ." And here's the truth. You don't want to follow somebody who ain't following Jesus. Huh? You don't want that. No. You don't want to follow someone who is not following the Lord. As a Christian leader, you know that the Lord's strength is made perfect in your weakness. So you remain in constant contact with the Lord, for Christ is the one who reveals whose advice is in line with God's will. That's why you can't listen to everybody. Because some of the folks who want you to listen to them are not in line with what God wants. And I'm not saying those people are bad people. They may be well-intentioned, but they don't know what God has for you to do. And listening to them can take you off of the path that God has you on. So good leaders follow Christ. And Christ will tell you who you need to listen to for this, that, and the other. The Lord is the one who tells when it's time to lead by following and when you need to lead by public display. God does this. The Lord is the one who tells you how often you should speak out on behalf of others and when you've said too much already. Or when you're talking too much because it's keeping other folks from growing. Paul was speaking to a church filled with divisions, infidelity, immoral and unethical supremacy, as well as spiritual elitism and spiritual oppression. It was all in one church. I tell people all the time, you think your church is messed up, read 1 Corinthians. You'll feel better about where you are. You really will. It was all in one church, and they didn't know who to follow in that church. So Paul said, follow me because I'm following Christ, and the Lord's not going to let any of us down. Remember, it's not the Lord's will that you fail doing God's work. Not the Lord's will. And the Lord won't steer you wrong. Again, you don't want to follow a leader who isn't following Jesus Christ. But you also need to know what Jesus was about so that you can know who to follow. You need to understand what Jesus was doing, teaching us what loving your neighbor truly means through the Gospel of Luke and the Good Samaritan in particular, teaching us how to forgive those who hurt you, those who offend you by dying on the cross and forgiving those who put him there, by standing up for those who can't stand up at all, like the woman who was framed and caught in the act of adultery, following Jesus, knowing what Jesus was about, because Jesus was kind, Jesus was righteous, Jesus was just, Jesus was humble, Jesus was loving. The Bible says you know a tree by the fruit it bears. Because apple trees don't bear oranges. And orange trees don't bear pineapples. Paul said of himself, I'm the chief of sinners. Paul said of himself, the good I want to do, I don't do. I do the bad instead. So Paul, who oftentimes is given all kinds of bad raps, if you will, and some of them may be deserved in some regards. But what Paul says here, he says, don't trust me because of me. Follow me because of who I'm following. Follow me because I'm following Christ. But you need to know who Jesus is. Because everyone who comes in the name of the Lord has not been called by the Lord. So you need to know Jesus for yourself, and then you can tell if who is leading you, who you are following, is truly of God. Truly called by God. So I thought I was through, but I got something. And then I'll be through, I believe. All right. So I went to college with a guy who wanted to be a pastor. I mean, he was dead set on being a pastor. I was not. Figure that part out. But nevertheless, he really wanted to be a pastor. So I said, why do you want to be a pastor? He said, I went to this wedding, and I watched this pastor handle the wedding, how he invited all of the people in, how he told where the groomsmen need to be and the bridesmaid need to be, and how he handled all of the arrangements during the reception. I said, that's what I want to be. I want to do that. I want to be a pastor. I said, I don't think you want to be a pastor. I said, I think you want to be a wedding coordinator. I said, I think that's what, what God is calling you to be, as a wedding coordinator. He said, no, he's a pastor. Well, he took a couple of religion classes at Bethel and decided he did not want to be a pastor. All leaders stand before you are not the ones God has called for you. Not all. But you got to be able to tell the difference. You have to be able to tell the difference. And one of the ways that you can tell the difference is when a leader admits that he or she doesn't know it all and goes to those who can help. Good leaders must also be good followers and must continue to practice fellowship. In Jesus' name, be blessed today. Amen. My friends, it's now time for us to give. And as we prepare to give our gifts to the Lord, the act of giving here in the Lake Highlands Presbyterian Church is done in two fashions. Yes, the first is to give our tithes and our offerings. And we do this because the Lord has said we ought to do it. Not because I stand before you or somebody sitting next to you is nudging you. It's an act of Christian discipline, loyalty, and obedience. The second act of giving, however, is greater than the first, and that's to give yourself. If you've come here today without Jesus Christ being in control of your life, this is a great invitation for you to make the best decision you can this side of glory. That is to have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe there's someone here today and you would like to be a member of this church. We'd be more than happy to have you as a member here of the Lake Highlands Presbyterian Church. This great invitation is for you. Maybe you are a member here, or maybe you're a member someplace else, but you've gotten off track. You're not living your life for the Lord like you know that you should. Well, this invitation is for you to start over again, to begin again. And there's no need to be embarrassed about that or ashamed about that. Many of us in this room have done it. Many of us online have done it. I have done it. The old church used to call it rededication, because we serve a God not of a second chance, but of another chance. This invitation is for you. Or perhaps special prayer is what you need. That's fine. That's fine. So as the praise team blesses us in song, if any of these have touched you, I would invite you to come join me over here to the side with our service elder for this month, Bill Miller. But if coming down is a little bit too much, and for those of you joining us online, I ask you to do this. Reach out to me this week. For those of you online, contact information is right there in front of you. Reach out to me this week, and let's talk. Let's find out where you are in your walk with Christ. For be it that day or today, we always want to make sure that it is the day that we get things right between you and the Lord. Amen? Amen.
Thy word is a light.
to my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Amen. Thank you. My friends, it's time for us to go to the Lord in prayer, and there's some things that we need to talk to the Lord about. For one, those who are part of this congregation who are ill with the stomach virus that's traveling around and all of these particulars, we want to keep them in our prayers on today, each and every one. We also want to thank the Lord, of course, for baby Felix, who is with us now, and pray for Josue and Vanessa and the entire family during this time. Keep this church in your prayers too, as we're all working and trying to find solutions to things that are taking place. But don't forget the one who has the answer to everything. So pray for this church. And then, of course, for our sisters and brothers in Israel. The Bible says that there will be wars and rumors of wars. That's how we'll be able to tell the end of time is near. The challenge that we are facing, my friends, oftentimes is that this started when Jesus went away. When Jesus returned back to glory, that's when the end of time started. So we should not be surprised when we hear of all of these terrible things that are happening. We should be concerned. We should be concerned and still talk to the one who can handle all of it. War is never easy. And along many lines and levels, a lot of things go unanswered. I can't tell you what to do, but I can suggest that you do as I do, and that is continue to pray. Continue to pray. For the Bible does tell us that there is a peace that passes all understanding. We just have to embrace that. And my friends, many of us don't. So please join me as we talk to the Lord. Creator God, we thank you today for your blessings. Sometimes they're hard to see because of all that's going on. But in our heart of hearts, we know that you keep on blessing us. The simple fact that we're in this room is proof of that. So we say thank you. As your word tells us, give thanks in all things and at all times. We say thank you. But we do come to you today, O Lord, as a people troubled. On many fronts, we pray right now for our sisters and brothers in Israel and Palestine, pray for peace and an end of the conflict. But definitely an end to the war. As we've been praying for Ukraine all of this time, oh Lord. Because it's obvious that we are incapable of finding solutions to our issues and our challenges and our problems. So we need you to step in as only you can. We ask today that you would heal your children, those who are part of this church, connected to this church, young and old, oh Lord, who are suffering from sickness, disease. We pray for healing as you can only give. We ask your blessings today, oh Lord, upon this church. We need you, Lord. We always have. But our struggles and our challenges as of right now are great. And we need our greater God to step in and to move as only you can, O Lord. And we trust you with all that we love and all that we hold dear, including the Lake Highlands Presbyterian Church. We thank you right now for the blessing that you have given to Josue and to Vanessa and to their family. We thank you that the baby is healthy, that Vanessa is healthy. Pray that you will continue to lead them as you have all this time. We thank you today for Hispanic Heritage Month. We thank you for all of our Latino and Latina siblings whom you have gifted this world with. Make differences for us, have advanced us culturally, spiritually, politically, in so many ways. Continue to bless each and every one. And now, Lord, we pray the prayer that you taught us. And we say this prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, glory forever. Amen. My friends, will you stand, please, as we prepare to leave this place on today? Please remember those of you who are a part of committees that will be meeting right after worship or later on this day, that you would do so accordingly. And members of the session, make sure you look and check your emails from me today and tomorrow. Now may the grace of God, the love of Christ, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, abide in each of us now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being with us on today. Thank you so much for joining us online.
to my feet and alive.